Welcome to the webinar about measuring methods, scope and applications of thermal conductivity and thermal diffusivity. In this context, the instruments laser flash analyzer, transient hot bridge, TIM tester and the heat flow meter are introduced and shortly described. Linsys Thermal Analysis manufactures instruments for thermal analysis and determination of thermal physical properties. The family-owned company was founded in Selb, Germany in 1957 by Maximilian Linsys, who is shown on the left picture here. And today the company is led by the second generation, Klaus Linsys, shown on the right. And also the third generation has become an established force in the company. Starting with the development and production of dilatometer and DSCs for the characterization of ceramics and porcelain, for which the region of northeastern Bavaria was famous for, Linsys emerged as one of the most innovative and leading companies in the field of thermal analysis and measurement of thermophysical properties. Next to its headquarters in Selb, Germany, Linsys has owned subsidiaries in New Jersey, USA, as well as Shanghai and Beijing in China. Furthermore, Linsys has representatives and customers in more than 70 countries worldwide. Linsys Thermal Analysis manufactures instruments for the thermal analysis of materials and the determination of their thermophysical properties. The product range includes a complete lineup of analyzers, such as differential scanning calorimeters, thermobalances, simultaneous thermal analyzers, which is a combination of DSC and a thermobalance, dilatometers, thermomechanical analyzers, instruments for the measurement of thermal conductivity and thermal diffusivity, instruments for the characterization of thermoelectrical materials, and last but not least, instruments for the investigation of the physical properties of nanometer thin layers. For more detailed research, thermal analyzers can be coupled to gas analyzers such as mass and infrared spectrometers. Linsys, as an innovative and solution-driven company, also has strong capabilities to realize modifications on the standard portfolio or even build unique tailor-made instruments. Before we come to the actual webinar, I would like to introduce myself briefly. My name is Erika Hahn and I studied physics at the University in Erlangen. At Linsys, I am responsible for the thermal transport measurements in the application laboratory. This slide shows the agenda of today's webinar. At first, the terms thermal diffusivity and thermal conductivity need to be defined. Then we can go further to the application fields, where the knowledge of the thermophysical properties is important. Afterwards, I will present the different methods and instruments which can be used to measure these properties, which are the laser flash method, the hot wire method, the hot plate method with the TIM tester and the heat flow meter, and in the end, an outlook for the characterization of thin films is given. Before we have a look at the commonly used measurement techniques and instruments, the next two slides will give a very brief introduction and the theory of heat transport. Fundamentally, there are three ways of heat transport: radiation, convection, and conduction. Our products mainly focus on how much or how fast heat can be transported within a material, and thus we focus on the thermal conductivity. And the total thermal conductivity of a material consists of a phononic and an electronic contribution, where the phonon part are mainly waves of lattice vibrations and the electronic part are free moving charge carriers which transport heat. If we now classify different types of materials with this knowledge, we know that the heat transport in highly conductive materials, like metals, is dominated by the charge carriers. Thus, the thermal conductivity of these materials can also be calculated by using the Wiedemann-Franz law, which is shown here. Lambda is the thermal conductivity, sigma is the electrical conductivity, L is the Lorentz factor, and T is the temperature. This can be an advantage, as electrical transport measurements often are easier to carry out than thermal transport measurements. Nevertheless, in semi-metals, semiconductors, and isolators, the phonon contribution is not negligible and can even be dominating, and thus also approximations get more complex or are not possible anymore. Another important point for the introduction is that a distinction must be done between thermal conductivity and thermal diffusivity. Both properties get mixed up very often when it comes to measurement techniques. The big difference is that thermal diffusivity gives the speed of a temperature spread within a material, so how fast a material can conduct heat, whereas the thermal conductivity gives the amount of heat which a material can transport. This difference can also be obtained if we have a look at the units, where the thermal diffusivity is given in square meter per second, whereas the thermal conductivity is given in watt per meter Kelvin. Most of the time, there is more interest in the thermal conductivity rather than the thermal diffusivity, but some techniques, like the often used flash techniques, measure the thermal diffusivity. And for that reason, it is important to know that the thermal diffusivity and the thermal conductivity are linked with each other by the density and the specific heat, shown here in this equation. So, it is rather easy to convert both properties. Nevertheless, these properties are also temperature dependent, which makes a temperature dependent characterization of all involved parameters necessary. Of course, people measure the thermophysical properties for several reasons, but the next slide should give an idea why there is interest in the investigation of the thermal conductivity and where typical application fields of our instruments are. One big application field is research, so that the fundamental transport mechanism can be understood. Apart from that, the knowledge of the thermal conductivity can be very helpful. For example, it is a crucial parameter for the design of devices. For example, the design of insulating materials for building or the heat management of components, like engines. If the temperature gets too large, parts can fail in consequence of thermal stress. This is shown in the figure on the left, where a material shows a crack in consequence of thermal stress. Another application is the simulation of casting, solidification, and sintering processes. For an accurate simulation, for example using finite element methods, we need matching input parameters. The thermal conductivity can be also used as indicator for material composition in the field of quality control. This is exemplarily shown in figure 2 on the right, where the thermal conductivity of steels is plotted with regard to their annealing history. The commonly used measurements for thermal conductivity characterization can be divided into two groups: the steady state or stationary and the transient techniques. When a material is locally heated up, the temperature distribution changes during the heating until it reaches a stable temperature distribution after a long waiting time. The change of temperature distribution is the transient phase, and the stable temperature distribution is the steady state condition. Both parts can be used to determine the thermal transport parameters of a sample with different advantages and disadvantages. For example, a heat flow meter or the hot plate approach, we call a TIM tester, use steady-state temperature distributions. They have the advantage of an easy data evaluation, and they can measure thermal conductivity directly. Nevertheless, the measurement accuracy is very sensitive to a long enough stabilization time, and heat loss is a crucial problem which needs to be addressed. The latter can limit the measurement range regarding thicker samples and thermal conductivity. In contrast to the steady-state techniques, the laser flash and a THB hot wire setup are transient measurement techniques which allow fast measurements and the characterization of a broad range of materials. In case of the contactless laser flash techniques, the measurement can be performed up to ultra-high temperatures up to 2800 degrees. The disadvantages are complicated evaluation theories, expensive components, and a necessity to know CP and density for the calculation of lambda. Derived from the presented theory, Linzeiss developed a broad product lineup for the measurement of thermal transfer properties of solids, liquids, pads, paste coating, and more. As each material type has unique requirements for the characterization, our comprehensive product lineup allows us to offer the perfect matching solution for every application. For an easy overview, we recommend to use our product finder on our website. The product finder is an easy tool to get an overview of the application areas and the restrictions of the instruments, like it is also shown on this slide. The HFM is used for building materials which are optimized to have a very high thermal impedance. The THIM tester is designed to measure thermal interface materials such as pastes, pads, and liquids, but can also be used to measure low conductive solids and phase change materials. One unique feature of the THIM tester is that it can apply a variable pressure to the sample and can also be used to measure the thermal contact resistance of the samples, which is, for example, important for thermal packaging applications. The THB is small, quick, and easy to use to measure the thermal conductivity of solids, pastes, pads, powders, and liquids in the temperature range from -150 degrees up to 200 degrees. This temperature can be extended with high temperature sensors, but also has some restrictions. And the LFA is the most universal tool in terms of both the thermal conductivity range and also in terms of temperature range. Various adapters and sample holders also allow the characterization of a broad range of material types and geometries. The instruments shown and mentioned here will be characterized in the following in more detail. The laser flash analyzer, shortly LFA, is the first instrument we want to have a more detailed look at. Fundamentally, the flash method is an optical, non-destructive, standard test method for thermal diffusivity characterization, which is described by an ASTM norm. This norm exactly describes the experimental setup in order to get highest accurate results. It says, a small, thin disk specimen is subjected to a high-intensity, short-duration radiant energy pulse. The energy of the pulse is absorbed on the front surface of the specimen and the resulting temperature rise at the rear face is recorded. The thermal diffusivity value is calculated from the specimen thickness and the time required for the rear face temperature rise to reach half of its maximum value. From this norm, we derive two versions, the LFA 500, which uses a xenon flash source, and the LFA 1000, which uses a more powerful laser for the experiment. The experimental setup is schematically shown on this slide. The setup consists of a power source, which is used to apply a temperature distortion on the backside of the sample. This is realized by the previously mentioned xenon lamp or a laser. Furthermore, some optical parts like lenses and an infrared detector, including high-speed data translation card, are built in. This measures the temperature rise on the front side of the sample. And in the last step, the signal from the detector will be post-processed and recorded by the integrated electronics and software. The signal shows the normalized temperature rise on the surface over time. For the calculation of the thermal diffusivity, it is necessary to determine the baseline and maximum temperature rise. This one is the baseline, and here is the maximum temperature rise. It is also necessary to determine the time required from the initiation of the heating pulse to reach the half of the maximum temperature rise. This time here is called T1 half or half time rise. With this knowledge, it is in principle possible to calculate the thermal diffusivity according to this very simple formula, which is shown here, where alpha is the thermal diffusivity, L is the thickness of the sample, and T1 half is the half-time rise. Nevertheless, what sounds rather easy in theory becomes much more complicated in reality. The experimental setup, which was shown on the previous slide, uses some ideal assumptions, which are not true in reality. For example, we have to deal with a finite pulse length of the power source, which is not zero. Or we have to account for occurring heat loss during the experiment. That's why the end temperature looks not like a horizontal line after the heating pulse, but a surface temperature declines over time. In order to calculate the correct result from the experimental data, a suited heat flux evaluation model needs to be applied. Here, the LINSCI software offers some unique benefits. While mostly classic evaluation models like the models from Azumi, Kovan, or Clark and Taylor are used, these all have benefits but also restrictions for different kind of materials. LINSCI additionally offers the Düser model, which is unique and combines the finite pulse length as well as heat loss correction. Because of this, the operation of the system gets much easier and the risk of evaluation errors can be widely avoided. This can be seen here in this graph. Here, firstly, all models fit perfectly to the measured data. And here, if we have a closer look, one can see that a combined model of Düser fits the data perfectly. As mentioned before, LINSCI offers two basic flash analyzers product lines with a very similar design. The more cost-efficient LFA 500, which uses axinolamp pulses of up to 15 joules per pulse and which can measure samples up to 1250 degrees in temperature. And the powerful LFA 1000 series can measure up to 2800 degrees. It uses a neodymium YAG laser with up to 25 joules per shot. The higher energy of the laser has its benefits when a measurement under more challenging conditions should be performed. That can be very thin samples because the laser still delivers high energy in a short pulse, but also thick samples because of a higher maximum power output and also at very high temperatures. Because the higher power output of the laser allows a bigger temperature increase and thus a better signal-to-noise ratio. Both setups offer sample robots for up to 18 samples. Typical sample sizes are from 6 mm to 25.4 mm. Our flash analyzers are very universal systems, since we can offer a broad selection of accessories like sample holders and furnaces. There are sample holders for liquids, pests, lamellas, round or square-shaped samples, for freestanding foils, coatings, and many more. In addition, all systems come with a sample robot, which allows a high sample throughput, and also the measurement of the specific heat capacity of a sample using a comparative method. In this case, the sample's heating behavior will be compared to the behavior of a known reference sample. The success of this technique depends on the comparability of the reference and the sample and on identical environmental conditions during both measurements. On the first slide, we introduced the ASTM norm and showed that the LFA technique is a standard and normed measurement technique. Nevertheless, we also show that the norm is only a basis and that our laser flash analyzer delivers much more. From high energy pulse sources, which allow the characterization of challenging samples to the most comprehensive furnace and sample robot lineup, which allow multi-sample measurements from minus 125 degrees up to 2800 degrees, to our powerful software package for an easy measurement, routine programming, and safe evaluation. The second technique which is presented today is the hot wire technique. Based on this technique, we developed in cooperation with the German PTB the so-called THB, the transient hot bridge setup, which is a thermoconductivity analyzer using exchangeable sensors. The main advantages are that it is very easy to use, it can directly measure the thermoconductivity, and it has a rather broad application range in terms of materials and thermoconductivity. It can be used for solids, powders, and liquids, and from low conductive to medium and higher conductive samples. The conductivity range for the THB depends on the model and ranges from about 0.1 watt per meter Kelvin to up to 500 watt per meter Kelvin. In addition, the THB comes with a fully integrated software, uses only a small amount of lab space, and can be upgraded with various accessories, which extends its capabilities. What makes the THB so flexible and special is the possibility to use different kinds of sensors with the main unit. The sensors use a built-in EEPROM chip, which allows an automatic recognition and initialization. There are three main series of sensors available. The figure on the right, as well as sensors A to D in the middle picture, show our patented THB sensors, which use an integrated Wheatstone bridge for accurate measurements. These sensors are optimized for lower thermal conductivity materials from 0.1 up to 5 watt per meter Kelvin. The sensors with a metal frame are suited for powders and liquid samples. These both are sensors with the metal frame. The sensor E shows a QSS sensor which can measure samples from 1 up to 500 watt per meter Kelvin. And the sensors labeled F and G are hot point sensors which are designed to measure samples with a very small footprint. Independent of the used sensor type, the fundamental way of a measurement is very comparable. At first, the sensor needs to be put into close contact with the sample. Then, for the measurement, a part of the sensor is being heated with a known heating power, and the behavior of the heat dissipation is measured using integrated thermometers on the sensor. Obviously, for this kind of measurement, a good thermal contact between a sensor and a sample is crucial. The contact can be optimized by using our accessories. We offer tools for surface preparation, a press for defined contact pressure, shown here in the middle, or special heat conductive fluids. Now, from the time behavior and occurring final temperatures under steady state conditions, and with the knowledge of the geometry of the measurement setup, the thermal transport properties of the sample can be evaluated. This slide shows a typical measurement using the THB type sensor. The bridge voltage, which is directly proportional to the temperature increase of the sensor, is plotted versus the logarithm of time. This here in blue is the bridge voltage. And the second curve, the dots without a filling, is the first derivative of the bridge voltage. The signal is required to identify the maximum slope of the bridge voltage. Here in the peak, there's the maximum slope. And after about 1 second, which is the time constant of the sensor, the voltage increases linearly over the logarithmic time axis. The thermal conductivity can be calculated with the slope of the linear part of the derivative because lambda is inversely proportional to the slope. In addition to the thermal conductivity, the thermal diffusivity can also be calculated. Here, the time it takes to reach the end of the linear increase is used. And if the density of the sample is known, the specific heat capacity can be calculated from alpha, lambda, and the density, using the formula we introduced on one of the first slides. The QSS and hotpoint sensors work slightly different and are optimized for higher thermal conductivities and smaller samples. The third instrument we have a look at is the TIM tester, where TIM stands for Thermal Interface Materials. Thermal interface materials are, for example, pests or pads which are used as gap fillers to improve the thermal contact between components. The optimization of the thermal impedance between different components and thus the improvement of existing materials is very crucial for thermal packaging applications. A classic example would be the cooler, which is connected to a CPU unit of a PC. But also in modern research fields like electromobility, packaging of batteries, for example, is a hot topic. Typical thermal interface materials have a thickness in the range of a few 100 microns to a few millimeters and have thermal conductivities in the range between 0.1 to 20 watt per meter Kelvin. The aim is to improve the thermal contact between the heat source and the cooler in order to get rid of the waste heat. So the pressure and temperature dependent thermal impedance are of interest, as well as the stability of these materials during thermal or mechanical cyclings. What is important to mention is that our system is designed according to an ASTM norm, which exactly defines how a setup like this has to be designed in order to perform highest accurate measurements. Many industries require measurements according to this norm in order to get reliable and comparable results. The TIM tester uses the so-called hot plate technique, where a sample is sandwiched between two plates, which can be temperature controlled. In the sketch, they are labeled with hot meter bar and cold meter bar. When the temperatures are applied to the hot and cold side, a heat flux will occur through the sample, which can be measured using thermometers in the meter bars. The heat flux itself depends on the thermal impedance of the sample. For the evaluation of the sample's thermal impedance, the heat flux and the surface temperatures must be measured accurately. The surface area A is given by the experimental setup. The measurements can also be performed in dependence of the ambient temperature and contact force. Now, if we come back to the important ASTM norm, it defines design parameters like the maximal surface parallelism, deviation, or surface roughness. The ASTM norm also defines how to measure the heat flow with the 2 meter bars, which measure the heat flow through the specimen as the average heat flow through the both meter bars. If this principle is used, a guard heater and thermal insulation is not required. In order to measure the thermal conductivity and thermal contact resistance of the samples, the thermal impedance of at least three samples with different thicknesses, in this case 2, 3, and 4 millimeters, is determined. From this measurement, the thermal conductivity can be determined by the reciprocal of the slope of the linear fit. The second information which we get from this measurement is the thermal contact resistance of the sample. This can be obtained from the offset of the linear fit to the zero point of the y-axis, which is here. If this measurement is performed under elevated temperatures, the thermal conductivity changes and thus the slope of the measurement changes. And if the pressure on the sample will be increased, typically the offset will get smaller. And that's the reason why we have designed and built a fully integrated setup, which can be seen in detail on this slide. The system consists of the just mentioned 2 meter bars, which are used to measure the occurring heat flux through the sample, to a cartridge heater on top and bottom of the meter bars, which allow us to exactly control the temperature of the hot and cold side, an electromechanical actuator, which can be software controlled and allows us to apply a variable contact force of up to 2.5 kN, which translates in a surface area depending pressure of up to 8 megapascal. And a load for continuous contact pressure measurement and a LVDT for high precision in situ thickness determination. Because of this integrated setup, it is possible to run fully automated measurement cycles, including thermal and mechanical aging studies, compression studies, or the influence of temperature and pressure on the thermal transfer properties of the investigated samples. And here are the specifications of the TimTester. The system can be used for a standard temperature range from room temperature up to 150 degrees. This range can easily be extended using a powerful intracooler to sub-ambient temperatures or by using more powerful heaters up to 300 degrees. The standard meter bars are made out of aluminium and designed to cover a thermal conductivity measurement range from 0.1 to 15 watt per meter Kelvin. In the standard configuration, there are either 25 or 40 millimeter in square or in diameter. Other materials like stainless steel or copper, which can be used for very low or very high conductive materials, are also available, as well as other geometries which can be built on a customization basis. The electromechanical actuator, the load cell, and the LVDT are optimized for a sample thickness range between 0.1 to 10 mm. Thicker samples can be measured as well, but depending on the samples, thermal transport properties, radial heat loss might get a crucial problem for very thick samples, where this measurement principle makes no sense anymore. In order to run measurements and control the system, we use our integrated Linsights measurement software. On the left side is a screenshot of the measurement program, while a measurement process is running, and a cutout of the measurement report of our standard reference sample VESPL on the right side. What is not shown here is the setup mask of the measurement program, which allows to define the sample and measurement routine. Like specific routines for liquid samples, viscoelastic samples, or solids, but also the temperature range, pressure, and pressure profile. The last instrument for this presentation is the HFM, the heat flow meter, which is another hot plate setup. It is designed and works according to several international norms, which are listed on the slide. It is designed for an even lower thermal conductivity range than the TimTester, around one order of magnitude smaller, from 0.01 to 1 watt per meter Kelvin. Thus, the main application for this device is the testing of building and insulation materials. The geometries for the standardized tests are often normed and in the range of 20 × 20 to 60 × 60 centimeters. The working principle is similar to the TimTester, as a defined temperature gradient is applied along a sample of known thickness, and the corresponding heat flux is measured at steady state conditions. From the equations shown in the upper right, the heat transfer coefficient U can be calculated, which is mainly used for comparison, as well as the material's thermal resistance and thermal conductivity. Nevertheless, as the thermal impedances are rather large, it is required to reduce occurring heat loss by insulating the chamber. For the measurement, high accurate heat flux transducers are used to determine the occurring heat fluxes, and Peltier elements are used for a most accurate temperature control in a temperature range from minus 40 degrees up to 90 degrees. This slide gives an overview over the instruments presented in the webinar and summarizes the most important features. Firstly, the laser flash analyzer was introduced. It is the most universal tool and can measure different sample types due to various sample holders. Furthermore, it can measure also highly conductive materials, even at high temperatures. The only disadvantage is that it cannot directly measure the thermal conductivity. Then the THB was shown. Advantages are that it is easy and flexible to use and suited for various sample types with a low to middle range thermal conductivity, which can be measured directly. The TIM tester and the heat flow meter both are fully integrated setups which use a hot plate technique to measure the thermal conductivity directly. The HFM is mostly used for insulating materials with a low thermal conductivity, whereas the TIM tester measures samples with a thermal conductivity an order of magnitude higher. With the TIM tester, it is also possible to apply different pressures on the sample. With the last slide, we want to point to a special field of thermal conductivity measurements, which are thermal transport measurements on thin films. Because of the different scale of the samples in a micrometer or even nanometer range, the experimental requirements are getting more complex. For example, the time scale of the experiment when using a flash technique gets shifted from the millisecond range to the nanosecond range. Nevertheless, the characterization of nanomaterials is very important, as the physical properties clearly differ from bulk materials due to many reasons, such as parasitic surface effects and high aspect ratios. And because many industries, like semiconducting industries, require accurate measurements on nanomaterials, Linzeiss has developed a strong product lineup for these materials, which would be too comprehensive for this webinar and thus is handled in the webinar Thermal Conductivity, Thermal Diffusivity Measurements on Thin Films, Measurement Methods, Differences and Applications. So much for the bulk part of thermal conductivity and thermal diffusivity measuring methods, their differences and applications, which should give you a good overview of the Linzeiss product lineup for the characterization of thermal transport properties of solids, liquids, pads, greases, coatings, and many more. Thank you very much for your attention.